A year. A few months, more or less.
And we can be sure that when this bill comes before the Commons again next spring, that it will be passed. We will have home rule in Ireland as sure as night follows day, gentlemen.
My friends, this is a day I hope I have never seen. I had hoped that the strength of our argument, the quality of our argument.
Not to say or mention unspeakable bonds of shared blood and shared religion.
Yes, all this. That all this would have rendered that nefarious conspiracy as dead as a stone. That Bonner Law and the Conservatives, why, that even this government would understand that home rule without Belfast is a nonsense. And Redmond won't accept it without Ulster. Oh well, it's here that we must take our stand.
We can do no other.
Indeed, but I'm glad. I am glad that I will no longer have to speak to political audiences in order to convince. Now, I will speak only to those who are prepared to fight.
Good man, Carson.
Yeah, the crisis is looming up, gentlemen. But my determination and that of the volunteers is certainly growing.
There is no place for discussion now. Our time has passed. We have demonstrated in our hundreds of thousands our absolute resolve never to yield up our citizenship. And still this bill will go through. We have always known, gentlemen, that our resistance to be successful must eventually come to armed resistance.
Exactly, Major Corbett. Exactly. And the men that we can rely on now are not those who cheer, but those who approve.
As for that, by the end of last year, every county in Ulster had an organising committee for the force in place. Amongst these were counties even ahead of Belfast in their fighting spirit and organisation.
Look only to Tyrone.
Or Monaghan. Our brethren who came out in such numbers to put their names to the covenant are following through on that promise in their hundreds.
Yeah. And led by the greatest and most distinguished names in the fighting.
Even in parts of Armagh, where our men, our people are surrounded and outnumbered by nationalists such as Cullyhannock, Crossbow Glen. Even here, our people are forming units and coming together to drill and prepare.
Our men have been coming together for 40 years to arm themselves, to be ready for the call to action, perfecting their skills in rifle clubs, finding weapons where they could. Unionist clubs have been buying rifles and selling them to the members, the Donegal volunteers.
Ah, Lord Nickroom's bell.
They've been smuggling armaments from Glasgow Gregory aboard the Ballymore.
Ah, but surely that traffic will stop when the customs get hold of
them. Well, they haven't caught on yet. But you're right, Carson. This supply is piecemeal. It is uncertain, time consuming.
Our task now is to draw together under the single banner of the Ulster Volunteer Force all those who, by signing the covenant, promise themselves, by all means necessary, to defeat the conspiracy that is home rule.
And to create a force fully equipped and imbued with a military and professional outlook capable of taking and holding the field against any enemy.
And quickly, sir, quickly. We have committed ourselves to establishing a force of 100,000 men. I have no question as to the quality of the recruits, but
work is well underway, Carson. In many cases, it will be a question of absorbing units that exist under different titles. The Young Citizens Volunteers, Trimble's and Skilled Force. And we will be encouraging unionist clubs and orange lodges across the country to form UBF units.
I have no worries on that score, gentlemen. We will have the numbers. But numbers are nothing without organisation, leadership, and armaments.
Lieutenant General Sir George Richardson will take up his appointment as commander in June, and the organisation of the force will be modelled on the regular army.
Modified as necessary to take account of our needs and resources.
So then we have a division in each of the nine counties. Each division then is divided into regiments, each regiment into battalions, each battalion into companies, half companies, sections and squads.
We will establish special units. Our spearhead will be the Special Service Force. Trained men fully equipped with arms, rifles, ammunition and rations. Volunteers from every battalion who will undertake to be ready at any moment when called upon. Our motor corps will operate in squadrons capable of transporting a full battalion to any point and with a rapidity, gentlemen, that will astonish every enemy.
That's most gratifying, Major Crawford. Our own motorized units. A splendid achievement, sir.
Indeed it is, and unique, I believe.
And we should think of our signal and riding corps, dispatch riding corps. We will not have any fear of our communications going astray or falling into the hands of the enemy. Messages can be dispatched to any volunteer unit within a matter of hours.
Yes, and the Women's Unionist Council have taken it upon themselves to establish our own nursing and medical corps. Yeah, we will be ready when the time comes.
None of this, though, gentlemen, should gloss our faults. Truancy is a problem in many areas. Some volunteers feel the sting of those who call them paper soldiers a theatrical farce.
We have always faced the catcalls of the radical press and the sneering of the spineless.
I am merely making the point, sir, that it takes time, effort, and genius to form, to build an effective army from local militias.
Well, we have no shortage of genius, Major Crawford. And we have no shortage of the effort, Craig, but we do lack time.
And arms. Arms, gentlemen. Our men need to secure the arms, the rifles, the revolvers, the light and heavy ordnance that will allow them to prevail against any enemy.
Major Crawford, that matter is in your capable hands, but perhaps now we should not speak much more of it.
Yes, indeed. Well, with God's grace, I hope to have good news on that front soon. On the day that this Home Rule Bill becomes law, our provisional government will take its place in the City Hall, protected by a fighting force with no equal on these islands. And make no mistake, gentlemen, they will be at war from that moment.
What do you imagine, Major Crawford?
I don't imagine, Carson. Churchill will send his gunboats into Belfast Lough and he will shell our government. He will bring the regular army north from the Curragh.
He will not. He will not. They wouldn't come. They would never fire on their own kin.
He will send them. I would were I in his position. Whether they come, that is another matter. But we shall be ready. And how long, gentlemen, before the Nationalists are fully armed and prepared to defend this legitimate decision of Parliament? We have to be aware, gentlemen, that every street and town in Ulster will have its nest of Home Rule supporters and radical agitators. Our men will face an enemy that is among them and all around them. Stern and resolute action will be called upon to drive these people out. Such an action as was undertaken by our brethren in the shipyards last July.
Well, friends, it's my earnest prayer that this will not end in civil war.
Amen.
And amen to that, gentlemen. But remember, Ulster is under siege. But then are we not the very boys who know how to break siege?
Major Crawford.
Major Crawford.